Eating the tweet. Just waiting for the first person to walk into the door. Yeah, so this is Mega Spells Mega Show. I'm here live with Veronica Nicotine Ripley.
Hi.
And let's see. So you're some sort of online gaming gamer, and
That's what people tell me.
you've done all sorts, haven't you? Like you've run a community. I think you've been in
Yeah,
some movies, and you're a Twitch
it's
ambassador. Sorry, I'll let you explain.
no. My name is Nicotine. I'm a role player on Twitch. I also founded Transmission Gaming. It's a huge Discord server for trans people, for trans gamers specifically. And there's probably, I don't know, how many people do you think are in there? Probably 3,000 by now.
I had to see him, you know.
There's a Twitch team for it as well. And yeah, I've been streaming on Twitch for a while. I have an IMDb page. I'm also on WikiFeet.
Yeah.
I'm on Wikifur, and
Those are, I think, the top two Google results for you out there.
I'm the top Google result. I'm not even kidding. Right now, if you searched for if you searched for furry streamer Twitch, I'm the first result. I'm the top result on furry streamer Twitch, and it's terrible. It's terrible that that's the case, but my chat has single-handedly affected the Google algorithm to make me not just the top result, but like interspersed throughout all of the results. Sonic Fox is like five spaces behind,
Really?
and I
Ooh.
feel bad because like Sonic Fox is an actual furry.
Yeah. Oh, I love Sonic
So,
Fox as well, yeah. But
yeah, me too. What a
I
sweetheart.
guess that just shows your renown, I guess. You just overpower everyone else around you with the fame.
I think my chat just likes fucking with me, to be honest.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, we're raided by Jack with 124 people. So hello, everyone.
Hi, Jack.
I'll play the little two intro videos I've got, one for myself and one for you. Was the 20-minute intro video I just played for myself. Okay, I put together a little video for you. I don't know if you like it or not, but we'll find out. Can you hear this? Okay.
I can't hear it, but oh my God, what in the hell? Oh, we should. We totally should. Oh my. Oh no, go this way. Go this
I
way.
remember that.
Go this way.
I might have stolen some of your YouTube clips.
Hello, baby. Hello, baby. Who's mommy's good boy? Who's mommy's
Oh,
good boy? It's
Conan.
you. It's you. Yes, it's you.
Yeah, you know that Furby clip. I
You're
think
mommy's
it's over
good
like
boy.
a year old now.
Flesh is
Yeah,
flesh, bro.
these are a while ago. I love these. Memory lane.
Skin is
Time
skin.
flies when you're a gamer online.
Yes, it's good.
Skin is good.
Blood is blood. Thank you. Trying to give me this bird close because you think it's funny? You think this is a joke, Mr. Simon? You think this is a joke?
You think this is a joke, Mr. Simon?
And it's not Mr. Simon, it's Captain Simon.
Oh my.
That's great. Oh my God, that's great.
Well, I'm glad you liked it. I had to put it
Thank
together
you.
quickly. But
That was awesome.
yeah.
What a little nostalgia trip for me.
Yeah, I think your YouTube might be needing some new clips at some point.
Oh yeah, see that's the thing though. YouTube's kind of a hole.
Yeah.
if I can't figure out a way to make like evergreen YouTube content, it's like just not worth my time. You know what I mean? Like financially.
Oh yeah.
Because they pay so little. If you don't pull like a million views for a video, you're getting pennies and like.
Yeah.
I want like to, I make ad revenue on make ad revenue on Twitch too. I think affiliates make ad revenue on Twitch now too. And like, I just if I made the same ad revenue on YouTube that I make on Twitch, I'd be broke. Like, you know.
Yeah, it's they keep changing the algorithm to benefit less and less people every year. It seems. I wanted to be an animator on YouTube once, and that's like that dream died like 10 years ago or something.
Yeah. Animation on YouTube can be pretty cool. I've seen some like really good animators like kind of pull audiences from YouTube in like a really interesting way. I know there was a has been hotel.
Oh, was that kinda, a YouTube thing?
I think it was started as a YouTube thing. I think the person, don't quote me. I think her name is VZ Pop.
Yeah.
I think the artist like got started on YouTube. And normally I loathe things that are like, you know, for exposure, come play our benefit for exposure, come do this thing for exposure. Normally I hate that stuff.
Yeah.
Because people take advantage of you really, like they take advantage of you a lot when you work for free. So
definitely. Yeah.
So normally I'm always really, you know, really wary of people who are like, just go get exposure on YouTube. But I think VZ Pop ended up like leveraging YouTube fame into a, I want to say like an independently released like animated show, which whatever your feelings about VZ Pop are, it's amazing. You know, it's the barrier to entry is so low.
Definitely. Like, I mean, I think you just need like to build that big audience, and generally people who want you to work for free aren't going to give you that big audience anyway. But
right.
So I think maybe people came in after you introduced yourself a little bit, but you're the founder of Team Transmission Gaming, of a news website called Meownifesto, right?
Yeah, that's right. I'm still working out the bugs with Meownifesto, but it is live. There are some stories there, and I like to think of Meownifesto as like a queer, sort of like a queer BuzzFeed. So, but a little more focused on like gaming and industry stuff.
Oh, that's cool. I tried to start a website called Heck Club, but you need like to keep writing articles, I found, and I've not done that with my friend Lulu. But so when did you actually start Twitch streaming then? Was that long ago?
It was probably, I think it was, probably 2016, tail end of 2016. It was on and off for a long time. I started and then I stopped because I was playing Overwatch.
Oh yeah.
And right when Overwatch came out, and I remember getting into it because I saw like Seagull. I was watching Seagull a lot, and I was like, oh man, Seagull's so cool. What a cool guy that Seagull is. He's so cool and good at games. Maybe I could do that. And so I got Overwatch, and I'm like playing it on my stream, and I realized that I'm fucking terrible at Overwatch. And nobody wanted to watch me. The only people I got on my stream were just like the worst trolls. Like, oh, they were so fucking mean to me. And I ended up quitting. I got dejected and just quit for a long time. I came back like a couple months later, and I decided I was gonna stream some stuff that I thought was really fun, that I enjoyed. And it was I ended up streaming a lot of KSP, Kerbal Space Program.
Oh yeah.
And I found out by accident that on Twitch there happen to be categories. See, the way that Twitch is organized, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, is that it's usually organized by view count. When you look into a certain category, or like, you know, look like a certain, you know, game category or whatever, like right now we're probably in talk shows and podcasts, right?
Yes. So I had like, to squint and
so they're not always games, but you know, this particular category that we're in talk shows, it's probably organized by default by view count. And so when you don't have a lot of views, you can't like just hop into Overwatch where all the top streamers have like 10,000 viewers. Right. Nobody's gonna find you. But if you're in something like KSP, then the KSP nerds will find you, because there's only like 30 channels that are live, and they're all about the same. You know, they're all under, you know, 100 viewers or 200 viewers.
Yeah.
So it's more of like a community, you know. I found out by accident that KSP is like a community. And then I started building a following in KSP. And then
cool.
I moved on to other stuff in Variety and then Roleplay.
Yeah, I've seen quite a few of you. Atlas, is it? You do the roleplay?
Yeah, well, so there's this really cool pirate game called Atlas. It's a lot like Ark, if any of you have played Ark. Ark was this really cool like dinosaur game that came out that was super buggy at launch. It didn't really launch. It was like in beta for years and years, and everybody was like super pissed that it wasn't like this, you know, stellar AAA quality game that went right when it hit beta. But Atlas is basically like it's almost like a reskin. I don't want to call it a reskin because I feel like that does Atlas injustice. It's like an overhaul of that game, and it's really cool. There's like so much. It lends so much to roleplay. I feel like the game that you pick for roleplay has to have some really specific stuff in it to make it really fun. And a lot of things have a lot of different kind of benefits, but very few of them have as many benefits as Atlas does. It's got building, it's got territory, it's got PvP if you want to, you know, roleplay out PvP. It's got, you know, like this really cool tribe management system, where you can assign like different roles to different people in your tribe or your company, you know. It's got sailing and mounts and taming, and it just has so much stuff in it, and it all works pretty well. Like it doesn't have that many bugs. So like I feel like Atlas is one of those role play games that's just it's like chef kiss. It's like such a good game for role play.
Yeah.
I've never played the base game. Like, I've never played, like, vanilla. I've never played it on, like, an official server. The same as GTA. I've never played GTA just, like, regular Grand Theft Auto. Like, I've never played the story. And the new one in GTA 5. When I was a kid, I'd play, you know, the old ones, but never played, the new GTA. Never played it.
Yeah, I found that with GTA is, like, you've either played the single player or the multiplayer. There's not a lot of crossover.
Yeah.
But,
I think I played multiplayer for like a hot second, but it wasn't really my cup of tea.
Well, I guess it's all just like, it depends on like the people you play with, doesn't it? Like,
yeah, definitely.
Like, aren't you, isn't GTA, there's like private RP servers or something like that?
So, in a lot of the dark corners of the internet, you can find like, like tips and little tricks to like try and get yourself into a private server.
Blackmail is like the number one tip, right?
Yeah. You know, you can like there's like, I don't know if how much I'm allowed to say, like how much I'll get in trouble for saying, but there are ways, if you look for them, there are ways to get yourself and your friends into like a private server. But I mean, that's so much work when you could just join a roleplay server.
Yeah. <know? laughs> I mean, it's just finding the community who's interested in you and you're interested in them, right? That's like the important part, I guess.
Absolutely.
And then not from there, it's just like knowing people who know people, I guess.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so I think I want to draw a distinction really quickly between like your personal persona and like your roleplay persona, right? Because like this is a very specific situation where how I look at it is on Twitch you can either be like to grow, if you want to grow a channel, you can either be like really really good at a game or kind of funny at a game. Whether it means like you're really bad or you like, you know, you rage quit or whatever, that's like, it's a character you're playing, it's a persona basically. And so like when you're really really good at a game, if you want to grow on Twitch, you're like queuing into, you know, high level esports matches with other high level players who are also streaming on Twitch, and then you're introduced to their content that way, and that's what people follow you for. But if you're not good at games, you're a role player specifically, instead of having to like rely on RNG to queue you into a game and like a high level esports game, all you're doing is basically just having role play, and whoever you bump into, you know, is one more person who might be who might be, you know, exposed to your content, or who might have an audience who's exposed to your content, you know, by accident. And it's important that I cannot stress this enough. Do not seek that out with people. Don't follow people around because you think they're Twitch streamers. They happen to be.
Sorry, I heard that the other day, like, I was watching NYU Game Center. They were actually doing a class because of, you know, they're all in from coronavirus. So they were doing a class on Twitch about Twitch.
Cool.
But, they were talking about, like, how some, like, people will just, like, follow around, like, all these high following Twitch users and, like, just you know, just like keep bothering them until they can like siphon off part of their audience, basically.
Yeah, that's the hope of a lot of people, right? Like that's what they're hoping is going to happen. But what usually happens is that people just, you know, it's like the little kid trying to fight somebody without any reach, and the other one's just pushing their forehead away, and they can't quite reach them.
Yeah,
that's what that is. It's you know, it's people who really really want that exposure, but don't necessarily know how to get it.
Yeah. You're saying you could either be good or entertaining at a game, but you actually like, aren't you both? Because not to toot your horn so much, but didn't you place quite highly in a pro gamer thing at Twitch?
It's true. Okay, wait. So TwitchCon has what they call Twitch Rivals. It's like the Twitch esports tournament. And before TwitchCon happened last year, I was approached and I was told that they wanted me to be in Twitch Rivals. And I'd been in Rivals stuff before and got annihilated. Not like a live version of it, just like, you know, from home. I'd been in Rivals tournaments before and just been completely and utterly annihilated.
Right.
So I went to TwitchCon and I found the Rivals tournament booth. I don't know if you know what it looks like, but oh my god, it was like an actual like arena. They had like an actual fucking arena with like these
like
huge flying cameras. These huge, like on a big boom, they had these flying cameras and all these lights. It was ridiculous. It was ridiculous. And and so I got paired up in a couple different games with, I don't know if you know, Zombie Unicorn, who's this really really sweet streamer. And this guy named Money and Zombie and I are talking on headset. We're just chilling and we look over at Money. We're like, Money, are you a streamer? He's like, nah, not really. I streamed once a while back, maybe twice. This is occasionally. We're like, do you play Apex a lot? He's like, oh yeah. I play Apex a lot. And I'm like, oh, well, all right, sure. So how this game works is like, all the plebes are like on these lower tiers of this. Imagine like a big tiered cake. And that's what the arena sort of looked like. And all the plebes are on the lower tier of this big cake. Wow. And at the very tippy top are all like the actual esports pros.
Yeah.
And so we were fighting against like actual esports pros in this. And the whole man, like as soon as we load in, like I'm basically almost immediately dead because I've never played Apex before.
Yeah.
And
well, this is your first time playing Apex.
This is my first time playing Apex.
Whoa.
I never played it before. I basically died instantly. Zombie lasted like a little bit longer than me. And then we're both dead and we're just watching the game. And Money, fucking Money, is kicking so much ass in this Apex game that he took second place. He beat everyone else and took second place in this fucking esports tournament. I'm not even kidding. So, but for whatever reason, Twitch listed me as the team captain. That's what those things are called, the team captains. They listed me as the captain. And so now in like Newsweek, like all the publications, it's me. I won the tournament.
What? That's amazing.
I won the tournament.
And that's how you become a pro gamer then, is it?
That's all you gotta do to become a pro gamer.
Well, yeah, because I stole that from an old Wikipedia page, so I had like no idea about that. Wow.
Yeah.
But
TwitchCon was wild.
Yeah, well, I guess it's cancelled this year, right?
TwitchCon Europe has been officially canceled. I'm a Twitch ambassador, so I gotta be like really careful about what I say Twitch is doing officially. But I honestly, I haven't heard anything about TwitchCon like San Diego, and I suspect it'll probably get canceled just because everything else is getting canceled, you know?
Yeah. I've been stuck inside watching the rain drip down my window for like a while now, so I can't imagine much being on.
Me too. But, me too.
I mean, that was before the everything happened anyway, but still. So you also wrote a book, right?
Did I write a book? Oh God.
Pit Who of wrote my Doom? Book?
Hit of Doom. I don't think so.
Okay,
I'm not
maybe
sure
that's
book.
Just someone with like the same name as you.
Who's telling you that I've been writing books? I haven't told anybody about my Sonic the Hedgehog the Gecko slash fiction.
Oh, well, I'll have to put that on my wish list. Just delete that from my notes. Oops. Were you in the grid?
Yeah, I was.
Okay,
I assistant directed. This it was like an indie film. Assistant directed. I appeared in it a little bit. So here's the thing with Grin. There was a film that I was in that was so when you're approaching studios to get money for films, usually the directors who want to make a specific movie will film sort of like a trailer sort of. Not really a trailer, like a short, like they call it a treatment, like a short version of it, and then pitch that, and then say, you know, if we had a little bit more money, we could make the full version. And so for treatment for that, I was the lead in the treatment for it. But but when they made the full movie, I assisted directed and actually scored a fair amount of it. For the theatrical release, I was a composer for it. They don't have a credit for it anymore because they went and hired a different composer.
Yeah.
But I was also I like appeared in it really briefly in like a party scene.
Yeah. I noticed there was like a lot of credits listed as swinger. Was it?
Yeah, it was the director had never been to a swinger party before, and it was really apparent.
Yeah.
To somebody who has. It was cute. It was a horror movie, but it was nice to be on set with so many cool people.
Yeah. I think I don't think I've ever been to a swingers party, but I've been to like parties where it's at the location there's normally like a swingers party going on there, so there's like a lot of crossover. But it's a lot more chill, and I think people think there's less like demonic rituals going on.
There's a lot more like there's a lot more glow sticks and a lot less human sacrifices.
I mean, a little bit, but I think that's like the normal amount at a party.
Depends on what you're sacrificing, yeah.
Yeah. yeah. So, yeah, I think maybe we'll move to the next segment. If you want to do anything, this will take about a minute. So get ready for this segment in 3, 2, 2.5. That's actually going backwards. Anyway, here we go.
Gotcha.
That was shorter than I remembered. But yeah. You still here? Okay, you haven't
I'm
run
here.
Away. Okay.
No, I'm here.
Well, this segment.
I'm not a furry! you haven't caught me! I'm not a furry!
Well, the thing is, I can't technically do real gotchas in here. But in this, I mean, like, back in character, this is all very real. So in this segment, we examine a damning moment of our guest's past, and it's up to them to either reject that decision to do the embarrassing thing or to embrace it. So
I've
managed to find some news clips from 1999 a global catastrophe. Shall we have a watch?
Let's do it. Yeah, let's do it.
A Senate describes Y2K, the year 2000 Super Bowl,
let me see
as a worldwide crisis. This book stems from a rogue cyber demon known only as Nicotine. And the cyber demon threatens to destroy us all.
Within recent years, disasters of all types and description have devastated just about every section of the country. Earthquakes in California, hurricanes in Florida, unprecedented flooding in the Midwest, tornadoes rip through the Southwest, and bone-chilling blizzards shut down the northern border states. These and other almost annual disasters. But could there be a new menace on the horizon? A calamity so pervasive, it threatens not only the United States, but the entire world?
What's happened over all the rest of the world? Those bugs are going to crawl all over our computers and make the planes fall out of the sky. Clear power plants. At Ishikawa, the radiation monitoring system has failed just outside the actual nuclear reactor itself. That happened at midnight. It hasn't been put right.
About today.
We started planning in 1996.
Steve Barlow is chief operating officer at Richmond-based Mechanics Bank.
170-page project plan that written test plans.
And that's what spurred by federal regulations and good business sense, banks have been working on the Y2K bug for years.
Computers have taken over virtually every aspect of modern life. Each of these items, and hundreds more, are all controlled by a computer-based system called an...
Right, so yeah, it's, as a summary, in 1999, you personally caused the Millennium Bug, is that right?
I can neither confirm nor deny.
Well, it's been alleged, and there was, I think there was a mild apocalypse at the time. Is that something you would embrace or you reject as a mistake in your past?
I think that the real mistake was leaving people alive to be able to accuse me later, and I've learned a lot since then, so...
So how would you, like, do it differently, then? Would you, how would you ensure that there would be less, I guess, survivors, or...
I don't know, I'd have to really, I think I'd have to start small next time, like a space station. maybe I could just have a space station, and then just, you know, work my way up from there.
I've always wanted to not live on the moon, but have like, I had this idea of having like multiple like brain nodes, like across the planet and like some on the moon. So like if a planet was destroyed, I'd have like a backup brain on the moon.
Oh yeah, that makes perfect sense. Yeah, I don't know how you found my dossier, but that makes a lot of sense.
Well, I am nothing if not a plagiarist, but you know they say that's people love plagiarism. What's the saying?
There's no new stories.
Pardon?
No new stories.
Exactly. And well, plagiarism is a form of flattery. That's the one. Everyone loves it. Yeah. So, I guess this is more of an embrace than a rejection. Then, would you say? Allegedly.
Yeah, I'm gonna call that one an embrace. I've always wanted to be responsible for something, and now I'm responsible for Y2K, and it's out there. It's public. It's been made public. I don't have to hide it anymore. I feel like a sense of pride now that I don't have to hide that.
Yeah, I think that's like a big thing of shame is that a lot of it is like what it does to yourself, which you can sort of change to some extent.
Like, see, now that we've said it, I'm gonna end up on Wikipocalypse.
Is that so?
That's gonna put me on Wikipocalypse. The first thing you search for when you search Y2K is gonna be a picture of me. They're gonna affect the Google algorithm. Y2K Twitch streamer is just gonna be dominated by old pictures of my face.
Oh no. But I guess at least it'll be on Wikipedia probably. So I guess that was the gotcha segment. Gotcha.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think I think we've dwelled enough in the past. I think maybe we should maybe talk about the future and what you want to accomplish with your audience, what you want to, like, new projects you want to work on. Like, aren't you working on a podcast?
Oh, it's actually, it's a tabletop RPG game. So there, so I'm super new to tabletop RPG. I've only ever done a teeny tiny little bit of it before, and I got lucky enough to get into this really cool cast for this game called Facade. It's based on the cult system, which is I guess this super like grimdark modern day kind of Eldritch horror tabletop RPG. It's really, really fun. The people who are in it, Pumpkinberry is in it, just like a ton of really cool. Really cool people are in it, and I don't know, I feel kind of just like, hi guys, you know?
Yeah.
So, well, I'm excited. That's what's going to be happening going forward. I'm going to be, every Friday, I think, I'm going to be doing that.
Oh, cool. What is, do you say that's going to be the podcast?
Yeah, it's going to be like a, well, it's going to be a, it's going to be on Twitch. It'll be like a, it'll kind of be like a podcast. It'll be, right. It's table story, and they always have like really cool...
Yeah,
production value. The ADR is always outrageous. they're great. They're great.
Yeah, that's cool. Like, I've always been quite interested in Eldritch horror sort of stuff. I like the idea of like unspeakable horror. I guess.
Yeah. Me too. This unknowable, unthinkable entity you can't quite describe.
Yeah, something that's inherent in the universe, that's always been there, and as long as you don't think about it, it's fine, but the scary part is that it's an eternal truth, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love that. yeah, that's probably what I'm going to be doing soon, this Friday. Also, tomorrow there's a big charity event. Tomorrow is Trans Day of Visibility.
Oh, did they have that last year as well?
Yeah.
Yeah,
there's Trans Day of Visibility, and then 6 months later, there's Trans Day of Remembrance.
Yeah, I need to actually put stuff in my calendar. Everything's sort of blending together now a little bit. I mean, it was doing that before as well. It's just like all the weekdays keep going by, like Water Underground.
But, yeah.
Yeah, so what else would you be, have you got anything else on the horizons then? You've got the podcast, it's quite a lot, you're meeting with like new people all the time, I guess.
Yeah, I've always got, you know, something different or something new, content-wise. I think once Manifesto starts really getting up in earnest, the coronavirus thing has really like pulled, like had made me like have to scale back a lot. A lot of Twitch streamers see that. Like we, some of us might see like an increase in viewership, but you know it's usually correlated to like a decrease in, you know, the amount of the amount of funds.
Yeah. Well, no one's working anymore, are they? So.
Yeah. Right. So a lot of my projects have had to be scaled back a little bit for this, but I am very excited about the tabletop stuff, and I am extremely excited about new characters I can play on roleplay, and just all the interesting stuff we can do. I've wanted to break into body painting for a long time.
Yeah.
I just got a breast augmentation, and like every person who's had a breast augmentation, I want nothing more than to just show them off.
Well, you know, it's a big deal, and then if no one can see it, you know.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. I'm growing my own breasts at the moment, but hopefully one day I can also get one of those augmentations and show them off a little bit.
if you can't make your own breast tissue, store-bought is fine.
Yeah. So, I mean, I guess a good thing about a tabletop podcast, our Twitch stream even, is that everyone's got more of a reason to be there every week, so it's a bit easier to organize. Or maybe it's more difficult.
Well, so like, you know, when you do a tabletop RPG with a big Twitch stream, it's a little different. It's like, you know, everybody's committed, and you know, they're all it's funny, like all the other people in this are like actual like professionals at it, you know, like they're like voice actors and like professionally creative people.
Do you, I mean, so, yeah, I would say you're professionally creative. Do you ever feel like...
I don't know. I feel like the little kid at the kiddie table sometimes when with some of these other people, you know, like... Like, I've always wanted to do, like, voice acting or get into, like, games and stuff, but you know, all my professional, like, entertainment experience really came from before my transition, so it's difficult to have examples of things.
Yeah. You know. I found that, actually, it wasn't so much a transition, but I was sort of, like, flip-flopping between two different personas. One was, like, an adult game maker, and one was a normal game maker, I guess. Like, you couldn't really cross over the showreels and stuff. You couldn't say, hey, look at this porn I made, because for some reason, it put off people when I did that, so... But yeah, it is sort of interesting, like, you've got all this, like, talent, but you can't really have anything tangible to show for it until you've done more stuff, and then you can't really do more stuff until you get more tangible stuff to show off.
It's one of the beautiful things about roleplay, though, honestly. I know I sound like a broken record, but really, roleplay is, like, one of the best things to stream on Twitch for somebody who wants to get into, like, voice acting or any of that, acting at all. It's just, like, you get... an opportunity to make a demo reel every single day in the form of Twitch clips. So, like, you know, you can really offload the responsibility of creating a demo reel for yourself by just chat, making clips of your funny stuff.
Yeah, that's nice. Yeah.
And then you can put it on YouTube once every 4 months. Pretend you have a YouTube channel.
Yeah. Well, are people really still watching YouTube these days? I think it's just
YouTube made a huge pivot to like long form video essay content.
Right.
The way that the way that they're structured financially, like the way that they structure their payouts for their people.
Yeah.
For YouTube creators, benefits long form content over short form content because you can put more ads in it, and they reduced the amount of money you get from ads, and then they raised the bar to get those pennies, so they part of their criteria for being able to monetize your YouTube content is 1,000 watch hours, which is almost impossible if you have like tiny short videos.
Yeah, I think.
But if you have like long form video essay content, it's much more tangible. That idea that you could do it.
I think the big thing before was Let's Plays, wasn't there? Just like lots of 10-minute clips or ish, 15 minutes.
But it really takes animation out of the game, though. You know, is such a fucking bummer. Like I love finding like interesting cool animation or like really interesting you know, test treatments, kind of, you know, short films type stuff, but like if all it's good for is people spouting their opinions on some dumb fucking thing.
Yeah,
then
you
what
got
kind
the,
of a hole is this, you know?
You do have the animated characters which cross their arms and say bad things about video games.
I think if I did YouTube content, it would be that. If I did YouTube content, it would be an animated character saying dumb shit about stupid things, just like the rest of YouTube.
Yeah, I mean that's the entire internet, I guess. Just people saying dumb things forever. Yeah, I mean, like, I remember when YouTube came out years ago and they were like, oh, just produce, like, another 10-minute content animation every week and you'll be fine. And it was
totally. No big deal.
Yeah, yeah. But I think that's sort of why I put a lot of focus into, like, motion capture stuff. I wanted to do stuff with, like, virtual puppets as well, but I haven't figured that out yet.
Well, you know, Grand Theft Auto roleplay is basically just for digital puppetry.
Don't they do the little mouth thing when you speak as well, don't they?
They do. Yeah, they do. Yes, they do. I've long said that roleplay is basically elaborate digital puppetry.
Yeah, that's true. It's not, I guess it's like it goes back to like Machinima?
The old
Red versus Blue Halo people talking to each other.
Yeah.
That was always fun. But Yeah, I'm surprised VR chat hasn't gotten into, like, to be a... It is quite a big thing, I guess, but...
I love VR chat. I would stream VR chat if people weren't so fucking shitty on it all the time. Yeah. I love VR chat.
I've heard there's, like, a lot of good private rooms, but like you say, it's...
Yeah, but if you're going to have a private room, then what's the point? It's not fun anymore. Oh my god.
I mean, it's... I guess it'll be like a curated community, but it's very hard to make a big curated community, I guess.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, so shall we move on to the Lightbringers segment? Have you thought about something nice?
Something nice? Oh, wow.
yeah, so just
No, go ahead.
Okay, well, I'll just introduce the segment. This segment I stole from a podcast called, Henry Kissinger is Pokemon going to die, not a threat, just a fact. And they just, at the end of every podcast, they just talk about something nice that's happened to them in, like, the last week or so. That's brought them light. And I always think that's, like, a nice thing to put near the end.
Yeah, I love that. That's awesome. Hmm. I have actually thought about something really nice, and I think a lot of people might have a similar experience. have any of y'all played Animal Crossing? I've recently got a Switch. One of my viewers was really kind and bought me a Switch, and shout out to Panda Love out there. And I got this game called Animal Crossing, and for those of you who have somehow not heard about this game, it's actually the cutest fucking thing in the entire world. And basically, you just play a little cartoon person who goes to live on a idyllic island out in the middle of nowhere. And you just have run of the place, and you get to reshape it and like invite people to come live there and like catch bugs and go fishing, and there's this cutesy music playing in the background, and you get to like plant flowers, you get to have a flower garden. It's just really cute. It's really, really cute. I'm not usually into cutesy games or like cutesy stuff. I usually stray very far away from it. That quote unquote wholesome content. But it is extraordinarily cute. And I did build a blood pit, so I feel justified.
Yeah, you gotta have that total contrast in Animal Crossing, otherwise it's not Animal Crossing.
Flesh is flesh. My island is called Blackmire.
I think mine is called Noodle Pool. a friend Lulu helped me think of that, but I never actually like knew about Isabelle before Super Smash Brothers, and then she came to my island and I got her to sing Undertale songs, and I died instantly.
Oh, that's adorable. Yeah, I had no idea who any of the people were or whatever. I didn't know anything about Animal Crossing, but when I started playing this game, I was shocked. I was shocked at how cute it was.
Yeah. I do sort of I get jealous of everyone else's villages, and I've got like these ugly little gremlins.
Me too. I'm so bad at it. I went over to Andro's, you know, Annie on Twitch, Andro's village yesterday, and I actually could not fucking believe just like how elaborate and over the top and ridiculously like pristine this island. It was like it'd been terraformed. it looked like the fucking like Emerald City. It was so beautiful. I came back home thinking like, oh yeah, I'm gonna do that, and I got home and just like my whole island looks like garbage. There's weeds everywhere. There's some literal garbage that I tossed before I went, just chilling right there. Like, oh man, this is gonna be a lot of work.
Yeah, like it takes like a day to move a house or to move anything, basically, and you can only do one thing at a time.
Yeah.
But I guess that's the Zen part of it. It's like, what do you call those bonsai trees, is it, where you my friend started getting into that.
They look like fun, and the idea sounds fun on paper, but knowing me, I'd either like pay way too much attention to it or like forget about it and it would die.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. You're only supposed to do, like, 10 minutes a week or something silly. It's
But
yeah, it's weird as well, like thinking of like doing a project for that long. I guess Animal Crossing as well, that's designed to be like played over like 10 minutes a day over years, and I've been playing it until 6 in the morning by accident.
We all have.
It is a very nice escape. But
yeah, definitely.
And I love collecting spiders to sell to people.
How do you get the fucking spiders? Where are they? Where are the spiders at?
Okay, I'll do a little Animal Crossing tip section here for you. You can go to any island. It works best on a flat island, and then you just like take up all the weeds. You like grab all the flowers, chop down all the trees, dig out all the stumps, and that means basically the only thing that spawns is the tarantulas, the beetles, and a third thing. But then you just keep running around until the tarantulas keep spawning, and until you fill up your entire inventory.
Tarantulas.
Yeah, exactly. And then you just sell them on for like, I make millions.
Are they really? They're worth a lot of money?
Yeah, they're the like most valuable thing.
Who the hell is buying? Who's gaming the? Who's cornering the tarantula market?
There must just be like one rich billionaire, like dog or something, with just like a house full of tarantulas.
I really like spiders, guys. I hate it. I hate that. I hate it the most. I hate that the most.
Yeah, it is a very weird tarantula economy. I guess the other thing is there's the turnip economy, which is a bit cuter.
Yeah, I still don't know how the turnips work. I can't figure out where to buy them. You need to buy turnips?
Yeah, I found...
Daisy May? I don't know who that character is.
Yeah, she only comes on Sundays in the morning, I found, apparently. So,
okay,
like,
I got it.
There's a lot of weird time gate stuff, isn't there? Where it's like, if you're not awake, you miss it. And
yeah, totally.
Yeah, so do we have any audience questions? No. Okay, cool. I think that sort of... Would you like to plug anything as well?
Yeah, sure. My name is Nicotine, and I'm a role player on Twitch. I stream every weekday at 8 a.m. Pacific, 11 a.m. Eastern, 1600 GMT for all you British people. And I play a lot of roleplay games and do Grand Theft Auto. I did a lot of Atlas last year. Probably going to do a lot of Grand Theft Auto this year, too. So, I'm going to start doing a tabletop roleplay game on Table Story that starts on Friday, and I'm very excited about it. So thank you so much for having me on. There's my social media. Thank you so much.
No problem. I hope it's, like, the right one. I just sort of, like, it's all blurry text to me, so I just copied it.
No, it's perfectly fine. Yeah. That's wonderful.
I think that's everything then. Don't forget to vote in 5 years. I guess there's always money in the banana stand. Thanks for being on here. We'll see you all Thursday. I'm doing a thing on Thursday. I just remembered. Same time, 9 a.m. PST. I'm talking with George Batchelor, who's a video game developer. He made a pug dating simulator a while ago. So tune in for then. Check out Nicotine on Twitch. When did you say it was again, sorry?
8 a.m. Pacific every weekday.
Yeah. Well, thank you all for coming, and baba booey, baba booey.
Bye.